just see in the background what the theme of the last leg of my journey is going to be. That little patch of blue there is the Pacific Ocean. I'm going to go up from California to Oregon, Washington State, Alaska, and finally right in the middle of that ocean, the state of Hawaii. Off we go.
Its combination of architecture, situation, and history makes San Francisco one of the most distinctive and beautiful cities in the world. Even the transport system is a uniquely reliable and lovable mixture of the new and the old.
Chinatown stop.
Thank you so much.
A truly cosmopolitan port city, San Francisco has its eyes to the Far East, which, confusingly, lies to its far west, across the great Pacific Ocean, from where many of its early immigrants came. The Chinese originally arrived here as coolie laborers to help build the railroads. They still keep together, giving San Francisco the oldest and best established Chinatown in America.
These are chocolate ones, these, aren't they?
Yeah, okay. Oh. Big one, come on.
Well, what?
No, there's one.
Yeah, I'd love to try one.
Okay.
Oh, they're hot. Nice.
Oh, yeah.
Really hot. Good. What's my fortune? Fooling You says, dedicated bachelor is one who believes in adage of wine, women, and salon. No, it's a joke. At least, kind of joke. There's your card, thank you. Golden Gate Fortune Cookies Company. How long have you been doing this? Many years?
46 years.
46 years. And are the fortunes always true?
Extraordinary that after 46 years his English could still be quite so eccentric. Which could also be said of this rendition of our blessed national anthem. But the Chinese always do things their own way, which I suspect is why they've been able so successfully to blend their culture with America's without losing their identity. Passing the now gentrified quayside, where the coolies, prospectors, and snake oil salesmen once tumbled off their leaky boats, I head up to Nob Hill and a meeting with a more recent immigrant to this great city. Johnny Ive, Essex-born and Newcastle-trained, is the design guru for Apple. The MacBooks, iPods, iPhones, and iMacs, they're all his babies.
Not many cities can boast such a view, can they?
It's all round.
And that's the famous prison island, isn't it?
Yes, that's Alfred's Rose.
Which only Clint Eastwood ever escaped from. Fabulous. It could be said that the two most influential Britons of the past 30 years are Tim Berners-Lee, who invented the World Wide Web, and you, who've given us the iPod and all the train of Apple products. Yet you both choose to live and work in America. I wonder if that says something about Britain or, more importantly, about America.
I think there's just a conspicuous lack of cynicism and skepticism and ideas are so fragile, aren't they?
Yeah.
That it's so easy to sort of miss an idea because they can be so quiet, or to snuff an idea out. I think that the sense of the inquisitiveness and the willingness to try is so important for developing those tentative, fragile ideas into a real product.
There's nothing fragile about an earlier design classic. The Golden Gate Bridge is the gateway to Northern California and my journey up the coast. I shall be traveling into Oregon and on to Seattle in Washington State before heading far north to Alaska and finally Journey's End in the far south on the islands of Hawaii. California has the seventh largest economy in the world, but it's not all high-tech and showbiz. Agribusiness is huge, And while wine may be the best known, it's estimated that the largest in pure dollar terms is weed. Mendocino County is the marijuana growing center of the nation, not least because under local law you're allowed to grow up to 99 pot plants for medicinal purposes. Sheriff Tom Allman is on the front line.
Last year we eradicated 344,000 marijuana plants. We eradicate so much marijuana in the summertime, logistically it's hard to get rid of. We had to buy last year a very large 12-inch tree chipper.
Oh yes, I know the kind of thing.
That we chip marijuana up, and if it's on public lands, we'll just chip it and let it go into the woods for the wildlife to eat.
So there are a lot of rather dazed birds flying into trees. And
it gives a whole new meaning to birds that are high. Yeah, okay. Right.
At the sheriff's compound, a crack team are preparing for a drug bust. But before I'm allowed to join them, I have a very special date with firearms supremo, Greg Stefani.
All right, Steven, have you ever fired a handgun?
I haven't. This is absolutely my first time.
Really?
Yeah, it really is. I've been a rifle at school, but that's it. Oh, am I lying on my stomach?
We're honored that you're shooting a handgun here.
I brought a Dirty Harry pistol for you.
No, not a Magnum.
Absolutely.
That would be the greatest honor of my life.
That's the Dirty Harry revolver.
Oh, my.
A Smith & Wesson Model 29, 44 Magnum. This one's going to be a little bit easier to shoot than Dirty Harry's in that it has some extra weight in the barrel and the cylinder.
Right.
This one's a wonderful smell. Now, you know, the old cowboys used to keep a $20 bill in one cylinder.
Really?
Because that would be their burial cost if they lost a gunfight.
Oh, my. Did I fire 5 shots or only 6? Well, to tell you the truth, in all this excitement, I've kind of lost count myself. But being as this is a 44 Magnum, the most powerful handgun in the world, and can blow your head clean off, you've got to ask yourself a question.
Oh!
Ooh, hot. Do I feel lucky? Mummy! Well, punk... Holy mackerel! Oh!
Oh!
Oh! You feel that, don't you? Oh! That scares the life out of me, that gun.
You had the movie lines up perfect till the last part. Clint Eastwood did not say holy mackerel.
He didn't, did he? He just slightly narrowed his eyes. It's big enough for my tummy.
This is the absolute
latest.
Newest.
Oh, is it?
2008 model.
Thank you.
Well, you're welcome. We need to take care of you.
Thank you. Goes in my trousers, which are appropriately bright.
We're ready if you guys are. All right, pony up, and it's going to go well.
I'm following our heavily armed convoy to a remote farmhouse where it's believed a large illegal crop is ready to be harvested.
We have arrived.
And this is all based on intelligence from your undercover operatives.
It is. Okay, so the first units are on scene, and we have to knock on doors by law. We can't just bust in.
Even with a warrant, you
even with a warrant, you have to knock on the door.
You have to serve it physically, do you?
Yeah, there's about a 10-second time frame. You have to announce your presence.
Right.
And then if the door doesn't open, and you don't hear people saying, just a minute, then you can go ahead and force your entry.
Right.
But forcing your entry sometimes means turning the doorknob and opening the door.
Right, it's as simple as that.
So now they're announcing, come on out, you get out now.
So they've made some arrests, I think.
Sounds like it. When we first pulled up on the radio, I heard it say they had players inside.
Oh, players is what the word you use for that, yeah.
Crook.
Right.
We got what we came for.
Which is all exactly as the intelligence predicted.
Yeah. We have 2 grill rooms in here that are full of plants, and there's another grill room up there. Apparently there's 2 people who are in the house who are in custody right now.
Jennifer, we'll get you the names later.
they were pretty quiet and they didn't resist arrest or anything.
No, we don't have any resistance at all.
No.
We're good.
You look pretty formidable. I don't think I'd resist you, I have to say. Yeah. That's great. So, good result.
Yeah.
So, Stephen, if you assume that marijuana is $3,000 a pound, and that each plant can produce 2 pounds, we're going to see what kind of finished product these people would have.
Goodness me. Oh, the smell.
So we have another room to our right.
Yeah.
They look like they're a little smaller. And then we have these. And what they're trying to get the perfect bud, the THC content.
The active constituent.
Yeah. It's going to be on your hand all day.
Whoa. Holy. That's an oil, isn't it? It's like an oil almost.
It is.
Whoa. That's very strong.
But these are all female plants.
Oh.
And it's just like life. The females have no use for males whatsoever.
These people surely can't make a claim in court that they're growing this for medicinal reasons.
They would have to be very sick.
Even if they bribed a doctor to give them a... Surely that this is clearly a commercial operation. It's nothing to do with
this. This is clearly a commercial operation.
Yeah.
I've suggested to our elected board of supervisors that if it's going to be legalized as medical marijuana, that we, the sheriff's office, sell these plastic zip ties that would have serial numbers on them, and they would go on the base of each marijuana plant, and we could identify that plant as being legitimately medical, and we would be able to get some money from it.
Leaving the heady aroma of Mendocino, I drive north to the infamously laid-back campus of Humboldt University, where I want to find out what's cooking with a new generation of the counterculture, from the student siren, Carmen King.
If you've never been here before, it is an all-women open mic. Only vaginas welcome on stage. Sorry, if you have a penis, you are welcome to be in the audience, but you cannot perform on stage unless in full drag. What we do that's a little different is we don't have a sign-up list. We think lists are too hierarchical, so we have a love bubble sheet. Thank you, Melody. So if you want to play, just come up. We'll give you a love bubble, and when you're ready, we'll just pop your bubble. Great. Well, I'm going to play another song. Kind of goes with the last one, about a bitch named Brooklyn. She's got eyes in the black and a sexy backpack. She drives a big ugly truck, but I don't give a fuck. Got sex, curly hair, wearing boys' underwear. She's got golden tan skin. Please let me in. Let's have some fun. Some dirty girly fun. You know what I'm talking about. Don't have to be the only ones. Invite some friends and have some fun.
You're a smoker of weed, are you?
I've smoked weed in my time. I have. I smoked my fair share.
So is this quite a weed-smoking college, then?
I've heard a statistic that only 53% of the students smoke weed, but I think...
Only 53?
Oh, I mean, I think...
What would your mommies and daddies say?
A lot of their mommies and daddies smoke, too, especially if they're from around here.
Do you believe it should be legal?
I do, actually. The city of Denver, I don't know if you guys have gone there, they did the Alcohol Marijuana Equalization Act. And so, I mean, they just brought up the point that 20,000 people die alcohol-related deaths in the U.S. every year, and there's none from marijuana.
You're about to graduate, aren't you?
I am. I'm going to graduate in 1 month. Well, my specialty is energy efficiency. I came, actually, to study environmental science, but it was just... That's ridiculous. It's just a bunch of hippies bitching and complaining about everything. Oh, this is wrong. And nobody ever talked about how to fix it, you know, what to actually do. And I call myself a practical idealist. I mean, I'm not running around hugging trees and sitting in them trying to get them to, you know, not be cut down. I use paper. I live in a wood house. I understand that the economy must go on, but the economy is not going to go on if we keep using energy the way that we do.
California is the only place where the trees literally hug you. So it's little wonder that this is where tree huggers, tree sitters, eco-warriors, and earth firsters started their environmental campaigns. The Pacific Northwest has amongst the most ancient woodlands in North America. Some of the sequoias, the giant redwoods, are over 1,000 years old. For the past 40 years, loggers have been at loggerheads with the Greens, for whom the preservation of the forest has become the clarion call for saving the planet. The pristine Rogue River Forest in Oregon is one of the key battlegrounds, and I'm traveling down the river with two arboreal advocates, Nate and Laura. They're taking me to a remote part of the forest to try and track down the red tree vole on which the spotted owl feeds. Now, this owl is an endangered species, and as such, under federal law, its habitat must be protected. So, if they can find a tree with evidence of red vole habitation, then an area of 10 kilometers around will be, by law, protected from logging. So, the vole's the thing to catch the conscience of the king.
This is the kind of tree that would have the red tree voles that you've been telling me about.
Yep, yes. This is the one that we'd be in.
With the big fat branches they like, and then the broken top that they can get down in, the little crevices and stuff.
And they live their whole lives up there. Mm-hmm. They're born up there, they
the
breed
females,
up there.
The females will stay up there their entire lives and breed and have babies. The males, however, come up. Yeah. And they, you know, have a little visit, and then they go on to some other lady.
Honestly. I wish I could be going with you. It's just I have this awful, it's a real nuisance, I have this awful cowardice. It's just come over me. So, you can imagine when I woke up this morning and I felt all cowardly, how annoyed I was.
Got it.
You're coming down on the other hood, it's bouncing around. Okay, goodness, send it down.
It's coming down in between them.
There we go.
Okay.
You want to touch it?
Yeah, you want to jump?
Yeah.
Let me come closer
here,
over.
Come back.
Save me.
Okay, so the way we test it is if you can put two people's weight on it, you know it'll work.
Then it's going to be good to go.
So put it between your legs.
Okay.
So what we do.
You got it.
Go like this. And so.
See that? Watch your head. That's why you test it.
Yep.
Spits do come down.
Yeah.
So now we'll go up again.
I lost a little bit of elevation.
But the actual limb obviously didn't snap.
Oh, yeah, see that big
one? Nope. It was a huge branch.
But better to have it break before you go up
than
when you're up there. That makes you nervous.
You good to go?
Yep. We're ready to go.
The Douglas fir bark has all these little, like, prickly things, like little splinters, where if you hug it, you don't want to hug this tree because it'll put little pricklies in your
really?
Corners. It's not a tree you want to hug.
What's your view of the sort of tree hugging classes and the people who stay on trees to stop the developers or the loggers?
I was one of them.
Oh, were you?
Yeah.
So you're a big supporter.
That's where I met Nate, was out at a tree sit. But I definitely support it, but I think, you know, there's all sorts of different tools you need in your toolbox. You check that branch.
I haven't gotten there yet. Hang on a sec. You get a little higher. I haven't checked the first
There's
branch.
No time for domestic spat.
It looks like there's a nest in it. I see branch clippings sticking out.
Oh, you see branch. Ah!
Yeah.
Don't look up. Both wear glasses.
There's a nest right here on this branch.
A bull nest?
Oh, you found one.
Yeah.
There's one inside this dead branch.
Are you getting a sample, Nate?
I'm getting a picture.
Hooray!
Yeah, this whole branch here is hollow. And it's just full of bull stuff.
Would that photograph constitute proof?
No, they'd have to have one of their climbers come up and look at it.
Oh, I see.
Because the nest material and the fecal matter they leave in there is specific to the vole. And so we just take a pinch out and put it in a little plastic baggie, and then we use a GPS unit to mark where the tree is.
Goodness
and then submit
me.
All that. Do you want to pinch a sample?
Yeah, I'll do that.
Can you save some fecal matter for me?
I'll bring you down a little bit.
Thank you.
It smells piney fresh.
That the forests still stretch for hundreds of miles is in large part due to the activities of people like Nate and Laura. And it is in this vast hinterland of Oregon that a creature even more endangered than the spotted owl is reputed to live. Well, according to Matt Johnson.
We want to prove the existence of the animal officially, and therefore get it listed on the endangered species list and protect its habitat.
Right. Tell me how you know that he does exist.
Well, my family and I, we went through the Oregon caves and then we decided to hike the Big Tree Loop Trail. So we were about a mile up the mountain around 5 p.m. or so. And we started smelling something coming downwind down the hill. And then we hear this noise as we walk. Very deep bass, guttural mammal, and much louder and more bass than I can do right now, but it went, whoa, 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 whoa. And we're like, we stop, it stops. And we're looking at each other like, what is that? We walk again, it, whoa, whoa, whoa. We keep going. We eventually get to a point where Mother Nature is knocking on my door. So I have to, hike up the hill through the brush, probably about a good 60, 80 feet away from my family, and I'm behind some brush and trees doing my thing. And all of a sudden, out of the left corner of my eye, I saw something move, and I turned my head, and I looked down, and that's when I saw Bigfoot walk off the pages of myth and legend into reality. You know, I had some people afterwards say, well, why didn't you stop and take pictures? And it's like, I have my family there, and I'm not going to stop and take pictures and risk losing my family.
So you're talking about a hairy primate.
We're talking about a very tall, hairy primate that walked upright like a human being. After we got off the mountain, we made a report to the park headquarters. And he said, you need to know that the park has a policy where we will not publicly acknowledge the presence of a Sasquatch.
What is it that they're trying to hide, do you think?
All I'm going to say, and it's just a guess, is that you saw what happened over 30 years ago when they declared the spotted owl an endangered species. Yeah. It locked up a whole lot of timberland, shut down a whole lot of logging companies and towns, and the state of Oregon is still recovering from that 40 years later, economically. Now, can you imagine what would happen if you identified a 7 to 9 foot primate species living in these mountains, how much land that would lock up, what kind of economic devastation that would create for the entire Pacific Northwest, Northern California.
Personally, I think its existence is about as likely as me playing in a cup final. But Matt is certainly convinced, and if more of this extraordinary ancient woodland could be preserved, so much the better. Heading up the Oregon coast into Washington State, and the raw energy of the Pacific Ocean is ever present. It's a different but equally invigorating energy that awaits me in the eclectic city of Seattle. Seattle is a more urbane version of Liverpool. Energy, wit, and a center for new music. At Pike Place Market, I meet up with Christoph Snell. He owns Seattle's Can Can Cabaret Club and is a bringer on of young talent who relishes the edginess and creativity of this major Pacific port.
Well, this, you see, I mean, this is fabulous. It really is. I mean, not many European markets can compete with this, actually.
Fresh fish off the boat, baked goods they bake right here in the market.
Yeah.
Right off the queue.
Turns it into an art form.
Oh, it's a soft steam.
This
melted in our mouth.
Oh my lord. Oh, they are. Mm. Seattle, of course, has got a reputation as, well, 15 years ago, it was the center of the musical universe, wasn't it?
Absolutely.
That wonderful word, grunge. but is it still a place of lively music?
Yeah, absolutely. The music scene
interesting. You know, we're in the heart of it. It's great because we get to see the beginnings of the music. So when someone is starting out, they're playing at our club.
Ladies and gentlemen, she just turned 15 years old! Please put your hands together and give a warm round of applause for Hannah Weeks!
Suicide rate in Seattle is very high, isn't it?
It's very high, as is, you know, the heroin use, and so these kind of...
So, despite the fact that it's a vibrant and wonderful place, it's also a place where kids are very disaffected and alienated.
Absolutely.
Is that also because it has maybe three of the most famous businesses in America? You've got Microsoft.
Right.
You've got Boeing.
Right.
Make all the aeroplanes and the jumbo jets that aren't made by Eurobus. And you've got Starbucks. I mean, they're three very, very famous world brands. And maybe the kids are all kids of executives or something? Is that why they all commit suicide? Because they've got hideous corporate parents.
Exactly. The weather has a huge part in it, I think, you know. It also, there's a certain melancholy state that I think is conducive to creating art.
Put your lips at my command right now. Fly me off to lover's land. Baby, don't you leave me at the post. Kiss me. You can feel it coast to coast.
Pacific Ocean defines Seattle, and while its weather may contribute to its citizens' overall melancholy, the sea breeze certainly helps with a hangover. A stone's throw from the Can-Can, I have a rendezvous with some aquatic denizens of the city, Carol, CJ, and Barney, who has a personal hygiene problem.
He has his own toothbrush, Mark Barney.
Oh, electric, yes. Toothbrush.
Uh-huh, Sonicare.
Lucky fellow.
Yeah, nothing but the best. Now, if we don't do this, he'll get gingivitis. Harbor seals in the wild have been found with gingivitis,
too. I was just going to say, in the wild, they obviously don't have this regime.
No.
Even with manual toothbrushes in the wild.
No, there's hardly any of that. No. Yeah.
I know, they really are like dogs in some ways, aren't they, those faces?
They're very trainable.
They bark and they have pups.
No, they don't bark.
Don't they?
They will make a growling noise at night. We don't know what, kind of like... Yeah,
kind of
like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
How old is he?
Barney's 22.
Really?
So he's an old guy. But probably in the wild, we don't really think they probably live that long. It's just they're so protected from predators and bad food here.
And like a lot of old people, he's decided to take fish oil supplements.
Yeah. All his life. And look what
it's clearly very good.
Okay, get Lamar. Yeah, start there. Okay, ready? Get it!
Yeah,
sometimes we get a little wet.
Yeah, that's right.
CJ has another treat in store for me.
These are our northern or Alaskan sea otters. They tend to spend a lot of their time in kelp forests, diving up to 200 feet or more. And then they have loose pockets of skin right underneath their arms, and they'll stuff those like a kangaroo almost.
Full
of food, and then bring it to the surface and use their tummies as a dining table, so...
that's the swimming backwards. It's charming.
Use a little food coloring to bring out the patriotic aspect of it.
That's beautifully done. There you are.
Go, we'll see.
Woo! That's a good one for you. I think he stood to attention, you know.
Oh, right through the red stripe.
He's got the fish straight away. Now, he's greedy. He's got the Union Jack and the ball of can.
They eat up to 25% of their body weight a day.
Yeah, your own body weight in quarter pounders. Oh, that number. Isn't that amazing?
This... Washington is the 48th of what they call the contiguous states, the states that adjoin each other on the continental landmass. Only two more to go now, Alaska and Hawaii. And I'm afraid there's no room for our cab in the snowy wastes of Alaska or across the Pacific. So this is where we say goodbye. Is Kodiak Island, the second biggest island in the U.S. State number 49, Alaska. And what a state. The largest in America by far, it's over three times as big as France and 13 times the size of England. What many people don't realize about Alaska is that for much of its recent history, it was owned by Russia, not America. The United States paid the princely sum of $7.2 million for it back in the 19th century. That was 2 cents an acre. There are actually signs of that Russian ancestry all around in the names of the roads and particularly in the methods of worship that are still practiced in this community to this very day. The Russians first came to Alaska as their empire expanded eastwards under Tsar Peter the Great. After Vitus Bering's expedition of 1742, sea otter pelts, which are the warmest of any fur, became a major source of revenue. Realizing how efficient the native Aleut peoples were at hunting, they were effectively enslaved by the Russian merchants, and both otters and the Aleuts were to be driven to the brink of extinction. With the merchants came the Russian Orthodox Church, which in 1794 set up this mission in Kodiak. Some missionary churches were not welcomed by the local people. Was yours?
Missionaries originally came to minister to the Russian fur traders that were here when they first landed.
Oh, so not to convert.
Right. Right, but he changed very, very quickly, almost immediately, when the missionaries led by St. Herman saw that, in fact, many of the local native folks were being enslaved and treated poorly by the Russian fur traders, and that allowed them to begin to minister to the native communities, which led to the church becoming indigenous very, very quickly.
It's estimated that over a million of these delightful sea otters were hunted for their fur. Today, their numbers have recovered, although they're still endangered. I'm eager to see them in the wild, and Lee Robinson, a local fisherman, takes me to the far side of the island, where he says he sometimes sees rafts of up to 100 of them.
I'm astonished by how beautiful Alaska is. I've been saving up the knowledge that I've been coming here and thinking of wintry wastes, you know, kind of ghastly cold winds, but you're not prepared for how it's a very subtle and extraordinary kind of beauty, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
What is it about this kind of living that you like, or do you think you're an unusual person? You don't like the human race?
I think I'm not unusual. I think most men that live in Alaska want to do this same thing.
This gets into your soul, does it?
Yes. I mean, I'm only being blessed because I was able to find the land and I got a great wife that will live in the wilderness.
Yes.
Yeah, I'll live out here with me.
So what's your attitude towards the rest of the United States of America? How do you refer to it? Do you go to the mainland?
Lower 48.
The lower 48?
48, yeah.
Is that contemptuous?
Oh, I don't know. That's what we call it, the lower 48, you know. We're up north, they're down in the lower 48.
That's true. So yeah. What do we got here? Is this bait?
Yeah, this is bait. This is herring. Right. I've cut it and salted it. And then we've got a jig there.
Oh, this is
a little squid.
Oh, a little plastic squid.
If the bait falls off, we still got the squid.
That's clever.
The one thing I don't have down here is hot, ready water.
You've just wiped your hands in freezing seawater.
Well,
Smell them.
Having them fishing. Yep,
smell
yep.
them.
Yep, yep. Coming.
Okay, hang on, everybody. We're going to move over to our spot.
Oh, okay.
Hello, fishing.
Hello, halibut. Just for the halibut.
Just for the halibut. How big can a halibut get?
I think the record sport cock is out in Dutch Harbor. It's real close to 500 pounds.
Good wish.
Yeah.
Me.
Get me out here. I miss my cabin.
I'm sure I can feel something. How do I bring it in?
Just spin that.
Can I put it off?
Yeah, bring it in.
Oh.
See what we got here.
There's definitely resistance. Oh, I can see it. What is it?
Oh, it's an Irish Lord.
Has it any idea how ugly it is?
Yeah, I think it does. Here, go ahead.
Where's the beast? Surely you can't eat that. Oh, sorry. Oh. Is that edible?
I usually don't eat them.
So he lives in the deep?
Yeah.
I found that, generally speaking, the fish, the lower down they are...
The uglier they are?
Because they don't need to be pretty. Look, what are you? You silly thing. Oh, an Irish...
Irish Lord. They've got a few mechanisms here that really kind of hurt.
Like, yes, a lot of spikes going on.
See, these are spines.
Oh, so it's quite tough.
Oh, yeah, if you get those stuck on you, they'll, they're really kind of poisonous.
Goodbye, Irish Lord. Bless you.
Yeah.
There he goes. Leaving my lucky Lord and happy Lee behind, I'm heading north 1,000 miles to Barrow. Perched on the Chukchi Sea area of the Arctic Ocean, it's almost entirely inhabited by an Inuit people called the Inupiat. As far north on my journey as I can. In fact, I've come to the farthest north city in all of America. It's called Barrow. It's more of a village, really. It's right within the Arctic Circle. And behind me, the sea is frozen. This looks like a desolate place. It's certainly as far north as I've ever been or would ever want to go, and as cold as I've ever been or would ever want to be. But despite appearances, this is a very exciting time of year for Barrow because the sea is actually breaking up, and that means a great deal around here. Henry Kinyak is captain of one of Barrow's whaling boats that are allowed by international law to hunt the bowhead and beluga whales that cruise these Arctic seas. Inupiat people are entitled to hunt for whales, but no one else is in this area, is that right?
I think 10 communities that can whale.
Right. Yeah. And how many are you allowed to capture in 1 year?
In 1 year, they gave us 22 strikes.
So it's not as if you are slaughtering huge pods of whales, are you?
We're not. We don't call it slaughtering. We're feeding the community.
Yes.
You right. know, to me, I thought that my mom and my dad breded me for hunting.
Yes.
When we're whaling, this is what we use.
Oh my goodness.
It's a whale gun.
A whale gun? Is that...
And
it's so heavy.
It weighs about 60 pounds.
60 pounds.
There's a propellant charge that's iteruk. What's that? Iteruk anyway.
Oh.
Primer. Like a primer.
I see.
And then from there, then you got the shell is about this big.
Oh my goodness. What's the best part of a whale? What's the...
Everything is...
You love it all?
Yeah. There's different ways that you can eat it. You could eat it raw, frozen.
Yeah.
You could cook it. You could ferment it.
Really?
And yeah, the fermenting is mikiak.
Yeah.
That's what they call it. And you let it age for about a week. All my kids love it, and me. Yeah. And the whole family. It is getting kind of warm because this time of the year it would be really, really cold.
Oh, really? You don't call this cold, then?
No. It's, to us, it's kind of warm.
8:20 in the evening.
Yeah.
And
the sun is still out.
And how long will it stay light for?
Right now, it stays nice and bright until October.
Good Lord. And it stays bright all through the night?
Yeah.
So it never sets?
Yeah.
If it's winter, when of course there's no sun at all, do you ever go out? You don't?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah. We have to go out. Yeah. It doesn't matter if it's day or night, you know, we go caribou hunting at in the winter, and sometimes it gets dark.
And do you find your way by the stars, though?
Yeah, stars or GPS. Modern technology.
Henry, one thing that Alaska is becoming famous for also is oil and gas.
The oil company's been coming up here trying, you know, talking to the whaling captains and the community, and they want to try to drill here on the ocean.
Really?
I say no to it, because this is our food. This is our livelihood right here.
Yeah.
If something happened and the oil rig or something breaks down and oil starts coming,
yeah,
it would contaminate our food.
Yes.
Our garden.
Yes, your garden.
Yeah.
That's a very good way of putting it. The cold, wet garden.
The wind changes direction and threatens to break up the frozen sea. The fragile sealskin boats are easily crushed by breaking ice. Thoughts of finding a bowhead whale are shelved for the time being as everyone scrambles to get back to land.
Right now, this is not a good time to try to harvest a whale in this condition because of the west wind and the currents and changes.
I can see the white on the horizon. It's kicking up waves, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the flocks of birds are coming in here.
We call them eider ducks.
Eider ducks?
Yeah.
Oh, famous for their feathers, making good quilts.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Eider duck.
They're real good eating, too.
Are they?
Yeah.
Maybe not all the way.
We harvest that whale. We work all night. It takes about 24 hours.
Wow.
By the time we're done with the whole whale.
How do you hide the smell from the bears? Because they have an amazing sense of smell.
Well, that's the thing. We can.
So
they come to the area where we're butchering, and we give them a warning.
Really?
You give them a warning shot, and if you don't acknowledge it, we'll shoot them right there to protect the rest of the people.
Yeah.
That's how dangerous they are. They're a supernatural being. Just one blow, it can crush your skull.
Boy.
Just like how they do it with the seals.
Yeah.
One blow. That's all it takes.
Yeah. So what do you do if you don't have a rifle?
Well, you hightail and run.
On a snow machine or literally with your legs?
Well, on a snow machine and boat.
Yeah.
Sometimes we got chased before.
There will be no whales today. But over the three-month season, the Inupiaq will harvest their allotted 22 bowheads, enough to tide them over the long winter.
Well, if I seem a little inappropriately dressed for the Arctic Circle, it's because I'm saying farewell to Barrow, northernmost city of the United States, and I'm going to say hello to the southernmost part of the United States. I'm on my way to Hawaii, which is apparently 3,450 miles in that direction.
famed Waikiki Beach on the island of Oahu, I ingeniously disguised myself as an absurdly dressed, overweight tourist for a meeting with Terry Pennington, a private investigator.
Notably dark sides of paradise here. Well, I guess there is, like there is in any U.S. city.
Yeah.
There's an element of crime and drugs and prostitution and government corruption.
Really?
We do a fair amount of criminal defense work.
Are they often innocent or cutting each other down?
I would have to say more often than not, they have actually participated in some degree or another.
But you might be able to reduce the sentence.
Right. They have a right to a fair trial, and we do our bit. I guess for me, the reward, or what I enjoy in the job, is helping people.
Yeah. You know, I suppose, if I was to imagine trying to do your job, the thing I would most find pleasure in would be finding a missing person for a family.
Right.
Is that something you've done?
Many times.
Really?
We found a homeless guy from the mainland who was actually an heir to a multi-million-dollar fortune.
You're kidding me.
And he, $15 million had been put in trust for this kid, but he couldn't handle the money. He would end up using it on drugs and alcohol.
So are there many down and outs in Hawaii?
You know, like any city, there's a fair amount. I think what attracts more to Hawaii is the warm climate. I mean, the beautiful scenery. You can essentially live on the beach here.
But you need the money to jet over here.
Well, you do. And at times in the past, we've discovered that different governments, municipalities on the mainland, to get rid of their homeless problem, were actually sticking a plane ticket in homeless people's hands.
Good to
dropping them off at the airport.
Go to Hawaii, but don't sit on the sidewalk selling false watches.
It's a one-way ticket.
Yes.
So,
well, that could be worse.
It could be worse.
On the other side of the island from Waikiki, the North Shore has a more relaxed ethos. Well, there's no relaxing for me.
Well, this is a first for me. I've never swum with sharks before. I've been in a boardroom full of television executives, which is not that far off. You don't throw them fish, though. Hobnobs, yes, but not fish. I may try that in the future, if it works. So wish me luck. I have to confess, just a little nervous.
No, you're good.
Right, thank you. Thank you. Thank
Take
you,
a deep breath.
Joe Pavsek, an ex-PI and friend of Terry, has been running shark tours for over a decade. He says these Galapagos sharks are docile. Docile? They eat seals even bigger and blubberier than me, for goodness sake.
Goodbye to the people.
There we are. Goodbye, everybody.
It's been nice being your host for how many years?
Yeah, quite. Not very good with smell, because I like to drown. Well, for the gulp. Okay.
It's a dry snorkel, so you won't get water in it.
Mm-hmm. Just float it to the other side.
Shoot to the back and grab onto a bar.
That's right. That's fine.
Yeah.
Okay. Say, it's not frightening at all, it's just beautiful. They're wonderful animals. Really wonderful.
Jay, when did you first come to Hawaii?
I moved here in 1969 from San Diego area.
In 1969?
Mm-hmm. I'm only 27.
In 1969, I guess it was a lot less developed. Particularly on the south side of Oahu.
Especially on the south. Yes. There's so much development that's gone on over there.
It's kind of an island divided into two, isn't it? The
North Shore and South Shore.
Yeah, and we're on the North Shore, and you're a North Shore kind of a guy, yeah?
Well, it's the country.
Yeah. In fact, I'm wearing this T-shirt, Defend Oahu, and it's all about the country on the back, it says. Because it's constantly under threat for the kind of development that's ruined Waikiki.
Since we've lost our sugar cane and pineapple, all the developers eyeballing all this land. Look at right there, you can see everything would be ocean view.
Yeah, it's so beautiful. So do you think you've got a chance, though, of seeking it and keeping this place free from development?
No.
Really?
Have you seen anywhere that's been free from development?
I think, alas, Joe is not being unduly pessimistic. It's the curse of tourism to destroy what it most desires. Hawaii survives on tourism, and with good reason. Its 19 islands, the tips of a mighty chain of volcanic mountains, are all staggeringly beautiful and surprisingly different. A short but incredibly scary flight from Oahu, and I'm approaching the dramatic coast of Kauai, the oldest of the islands and to many the most Polynesian of them all. Titus Kinimaka is a native of Kauai and a celebrated champion surfer and mean plucker of the ukulele.
It's just
heavenly.
It's really a special place. Hawaii is very special. And Hawaii is the oldest island. It's the first island out of the sea.
This island has been populated by Hawaiians for, you know, thousands of years.
You're also part of America.
Yeah, we've become very civilized.
Do you feel American? If someone asked you what your nationality was, would you say American?
I am Hawaiian.
Yeah.
And I will always be Hawaiian. And my family, I can trace back my family about 500 years.
Really?
Yeah.
So that's before...
And our family is from Kauai.
That's before the British, which I notice is still in the Hawaiian flag, Captain Cook, before he arrived.
Yeah, Captain Cook, he was probably one that started it all, yeah?
Yes, I apologize for that.
Yes.
And then, it wasn't after him, it was Thomas Cook, the holiday man.
So. But, you know, they came over here and they're, I believe in timing, you know?
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. I guess they had bad timing. He ended up in the pot.
He did, didn't he? He was, because the first time he came, he was welcomed.
Yeah.
The second time, eaten.
Yeah.
But the cooking of Cook didn't deter the tourists for long. All around the world, you see local people who are caught in the fact that tourism does bring in instant cash and therefore is very tempting. On the other hand, it completely changes the very thing that is special to them and to the rest of the world.
Exactly, which is, you know, the values that we should all as Hawaiians hang on to, because as soon as there's a hurricane here in Hawaii, everybody's gone. Everybody who supposedly lives here on Kauai goes back home to wherever they come from.
Right.
So they got another house somewhere else, but, you know, we're still here.
And so do you resent that? Because obviously rich people...
No, I don't resent that. I just like to make it clear that I know that, you know, when storms come, everybody else has a place to go.
It's the definition of a fair weather friend.
Yeah, exactly.
Titus inveigles me to join up with some of his family for a quick paddle to his home on one of the most stunning beaches I've ever been to.
It's quite hard to resist humming the theme tune from Hawaii Five-O, which everybody does, of course.
a terrible cliche, but it's hard to resist.
No, that's it. That's what everybody can relate to.
Yeah.
In the world, is the Hawaii Five-0 and the canoe paddling, and yeah, you're actually doing it.
That's it. I never thought the day would come. Oh. I like that. Thank you for that.
A hike and a paddle.
A hike and a paddle. What a day.
Full day.
What a day I've had.
Polynesian hospitality requires Titus to prepare a traditional hula. That means singing, dancing, and the obligatory picket.
It's not like you go to the office every day. This actually is your life. This is how people live.
Yeah.
With music,
this is what we're doing.
Food.
This is magic. Look at this. Look at this.
It sometimes gets as cold as 72 degrees, doesn't it?
Ooh. It's bad. It's chilly, man. I'll have to put a long sleeve shirt on.
A long sleeve shirt? Yeah. Well, there. You see, now that's the reason I have to leave. I can't possibly live in a place where I'd have to wear a long sleeve shirt.
You know, it's hard. Mm. But we try to endure it.
Good luck, you swine. And talking swine, can we have some more of this?
Yeah, speaking of.
This is wonderful.
Big Island is, as its name suggests, the biggest island of the archipelago, and it's also the most recent. The tallest of its five volcanoes, Mauna Kea, rises 14,000 feet above sea level. High above the clouds and the distorting effects of the Earth's atmosphere, it is one of the very best places on the planet from which to observe the heavens. The Keck Observatory has the largest optical telescope in the world. Its stereoscopic lens allows it to probe deep into space to the very origins of the universe, which is why astrophysicist Alex Filipenko loves the place so much that he even got married here.
Let me show you the most powerful explosion we've ever found.
Oh, yes, please.
Wow. Okay.
Oh.
This is a fabulous one. Watch this star. Before it exploded, it actually had a double ejection like this. This was not the end of its life. That was an explosion before the end. There's the explosion at the end.
So those two sort of like bags of, what are they?
They're lobes of debris.
Lobes, that's a good
word. Yeah, double lobes. This star ejected maybe 10 or 20 years before its colossal death. So there was this relatively gentle ejection. That's relatively gentle.
Wouldn't want to be in the middle.
And then a colossal explosion. Just bam, right? Not only are they billions of times more powerful than the sun, but they're crucial for life as we know it. Did you realize that the heavy elements of which you're made, the carbon in your cells, the calcium in your bones, the oxygen that you breathe, the iron in your red blood cells, all of those elements were cooked up in the nuclear furnaces deep inside stars and then blown out into the cosmos by these colossal explosions. Really? So you, as Carl Sagan used to say, are made of star stuff.
Are you an optimist about man's place in the universe? Do you think we'll screw it up before we get a chance to save it, or do you think we'll save it before
Steven,
we screw it?
That's the million-dollar question.
Yeah.
You know, one depressing possibility that explains why we haven't found any clear signals from any extraterrestrials is that something that comes along with higher intelligence is this self-destructive ability.
Yeah.
So what if civilizations out there, the intelligent ones, just go flash in the night? They don't last long enough to explore the rest of our Milky Way galaxy.
Maybe cultures and societies are like the systems you discovered, that they have their supernovas too.
Well, I'm hoping that humans will overcome their difficulties and will last a very, very long time and will someday go out and populate planetary systems around other stars.
I leave Alex and his wonderful and very American sense of optimism
for a flight over the lava fields that are still spewing forth molten rock that cools to form new land.
Wow, that's extraordinary. Nature's furnace. You can see why people used to believe in hell. It looks like the entrance to the underworld, doesn't it? And you'll have to take my word for it, you can actually feel the heat from up here. I've never seen anything like it in my life.
Well, here my journey has to end, because here America ends. This is as far south as you can get in the whole United States. Actually, no. America doesn't end here, because new America is being made all the time by these extraordinary volcanic forces. In fact, in the last 6 weeks, a whole 20 acres of new America was made. It's a country that's constantly being reborn.
Looking down on the geological melting pot of America, I think back over the weeks of this astonishing journey through 50 states of being. United or not, a force for good or ill, they make up the United States of America, a land of matchless variety, beauty, energy,